Sharmila, hearty welcome you all to the inaugural ceremony of MHRD sponsored global initiative of academic networks, that is GYAN program on digital payments technology for cashless society, organized by Department of Studies and Research in Computer Science, Mangalore University. It is an initiation of NITI Aayog. We have with us Shri Ratan P. Watar, Principal Advisor, NITI Aayog and Member Secretary, Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister. Shri B. N. Satpathy, Senior Consultant, Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister, NITI Aayog. Professor H. R. Rao, Resource Person, GYAN Program, Professor of Computer Science, University of Texas, USA. Professor B. S. Nagendra Prakash, Registrar, Mangalore University. Professor K. M. Balakrishna, Professor of Physics and Dean, Faculty of Science and Technology, Mangalore University. Professor Manjaya D. H., Chairman, Department of Computer Science, Mangalore University. Professor Ganesh Sanjeev, Professor of Physics and GYAN Local Coordinator, Mangalore University. Professor B. S. Shekhar, Professor of Computer Science and GYAN Course Coordinator, Mangalore University. We have with us Shri K. Rajeshwar Rao. I request Professor B. S. Shekhar to escort the degrees to their dais. I invite Ms. Apurva and Ms. Sheetala to invoke the Almighty's blessings through prayer. I request all to kindly raise for the prayer.
महाकाव्यनाटकादिप्रियं मूषिकवाहनमोदकाप्रियं महागणपतिं मनसा स्मरामि महागणपतिं मनसा स्मरामि वसिष्ठवामदेवारिवन्दितमहागणपतिम्
Always smiles and smile is a logo for welcome. We have with us Professor B. S. Nagendra Prakash, our beloved registrar, Mangalore University, who is backbone of all the activities of our university. I request him to welcome and introduce the guests of today's program to the audience.
To begin with, it's really a beautiful day to begin with in the morning on a Monday. Weekend, we are fresh. Wishing everyone a very warm welcome to everyone. It is not only warm for me today, but probably this initiative has given me extra vigor and extra energy in being associated with this particular initiative by our university. At the outset, I deem this a privilege to welcome I don't call them our guests. I call them a part of the Mangalore University's initiative, not only for today, but in the days to come. We have with us Sri Ratan Vatwal, the principal advisor, Niti Aayog, and the member secretary. Sir, I am indeed privileged to have you on our campus and be a part of the initiatives that this university is undertaking. I deem this a privilege on behalf of the Mangalore University and my Honorable Vice Chancellor in his absence, and myself on the personal front. I extend a very warm welcome on behalf of my university. I am indeed privileged to have you on this campus. Similarly, so we have with us Sri Satpathy, senior consultant, Niti Aayog. I am indeed happy and privileged to have you also, sir. On behalf of the university and my Honorable Vice Chancellor and my on the personal front, I extend a hearty welcome to you. Along with it, we have yet another distinguished personality and one of the academicians with us who is here to share and disseminate knowledge so that not just the audience, my colleagues as well, are enriched in Professor H.R. Rao, Professor of Computer Science, UTSA, and ATT, Distinguished Chair in Infrastructure Assurance and Security, San Antonio College of Business, University of Texas, USA. I extend, I am indeed privileged, sir. I am sure by your presence and your rich experience would only enrich all of us here in trying to prepare a blueprint for the days ahead of us in much more areas of familiarity, so that the university at large and the students in particular are benefited optimally by your presence and your experience and dissemination of knowledge. I am indeed really honored to have you on our campus. I wish you a warm welcome to you. In absentia, I also, because of some official emergency, the Honorable Vice Chancellor had to do the honors. But it was then I was asked by the coordinator to do this job as well. In absentia, I extend a warm welcome to our Honorable Vice Chancellor too, because it was he who has initiated this work, without whose patronage this would have not seen the light of the day. I extend an in absentia warm welcome to my Honorable Vice Chancellor. And again, particularly behind the scene, people who have been steadfastly coordinating and making this program to reach this and culminate in this stage. We have with us our Dean in Professor Balakrishna, followed by our other esteemed colleagues, Balakrishna, Dean, Science Faculty, and and my other colleagues of the university in Professor Chairman Professor Manjaya, Department of Chairman Computer Science, Professor B. H. Shekhar, Course Coordinator, Professor Ganesh Sanjeev. As well, we have another dignitary on stage, also from the Niti Aayog, Professor Rajeshwar Rao. I extend a warm welcome to you also, sir, on behalf of the university and myself and my Honorable Vice Chancellor. My other esteemed colleagues of the university from the various departments, the participants for this program, be it the in-house students or our delegates from various other parts of the country or within the country, I extend a warm welcome to each one of you. And finally, I am indeed indebted even for the
this is here.
My friends from the press fraternity to give this a large coverage so that this becomes an outreach program and reaches many people, only to send the message that this initiative from our end is just the beginning and it is going to be an ongoing thing in the days ahead of us. We have a whole lot of things which is up our sleeves. I thank and extend a warm welcome to my press friends here, both the print and electronic media. A warm welcome to you also. We have the principal advisor to the Prime Minister here. Can we think of a better person in this initiative? Sir, we have a stellar role to play. As I repeat once again, right, Ray, yesterday in an informal way, we were just discussing that some of the IITs are having 129, 159 courses in the offering. I assure you, Mangalore University is no way inferior to any of the IITs. Whatever from the administrative end to meet that, it is not a target which I look at, not the number which I look at, how far we could be proactive in implementing the policies of the government and how we can take it forward and how this university could bridge the gap between the policy making body and the university play a stellar role in this one. So, Mr. Ratan Watang is the principal advisor of Niti Aayog and member secretary to the PM. He has served the government of India in various capacities, including the Prime Minister's office, the International Monetary Fund, and the government of Andhra Pradesh. He has a unique exposure to government policy making. He has also served the Union government in the areas of human resource development, renewable energy, petroleum, and natural gas regulations, defense expenditure, and external affairs. He has also been a member of the Space Commission and the Atomic Energy Commission and the director in the National Highways Authority of India. We thank Mr. Watan for taking the initiative and proposing this GYAN program. Sir, it is an indeed privilege to have you with us. Your area of expertise could come not just handy. I deem it Mangalore University is privileged to have you, and particularly your experiences in various fields. I think we are setting different benchmarks in various your allied fields too, particularly renewable energy, etc., where the university has made landmark initiatives already. We have with us another distinguished academician indeed, and I deem it a proud privilege to read his brief introduction about Professor H.R. Rao. Rao is a professor of computer science, UTSA, and AT&T Distinguished Chair in Infrastructure Assurance and Security, San Antonio College of Business, University of Texas. Professor Rao, a graduate of Purdue University and the FBI Citizens Academy, he has to his credentials published more than 200 papers, 125 in journals, and several best papers at ISR, AMIC, and ICI, and co-credited 4 books, and he is a chair of IFIP. Co-editor-in-chief of IS Frontiers, advisor-editor of DSS, associate-editor of ACS, and senior editor at MIS Quarterly, recipient of the Fulbright Fellowship in 2004, ISST Fellow Award in 2006, and research funding of the National Science Foundation, the Department of Defense, and the Canadian Embassy. Logistically, Mangalore has, because of its location here, sir, I think we have up our sleeve many, even in terms of defense. Your academic brilliance and would be a treasure house that you wish to share with us. With this could be an initiative by your good selves for a continued program in various programs that this GYAN has envisaged in the days to come, and particularly what is very much an apt one for the days: digital payments, a technology for classes, cashless society. I think probably this is one of the very thrust areas that the government policy is trying to do. And probably, particularly, I feel that it is a more relevant one, particularly in terms of an outreach program between the industry and the government policy-making body, and particularly the people, to create an awareness, not only an awareness, so that Mangalore could be a standout area of an institution which is going or extending the extra arm length to bring this one into place among all universities. I think your experience, your exposure, you're always, because of your experience and the background that you have, we have a lot to learn from Professor Rao. I incidentally, just when I was just having an informal chat with him, I thought he just disclosed, I learned that he is another expert in cyber securities. Probably another area which we could really dwell upon in the days to come. I look forward for your continued association with this university in future, not just in this capacity as only a GYAN program, but I look forward for a continued program. I hope, I am also happy that he is a localite here, that he is from this very place. He has his roots from this very place. Probably if you can think that this could be your alma mater, probably I look forward for a much more fruitful, a thought-provoking association between Mangalore University and your good selves. And probably if there are avenues for any MOU that could be possibly associated with your universities, we have already associations with a number of universities, overseas universities. I look forward to seeing from your university too. I extend a warm welcome, and I'm really privileged to have you. Only to say that I think the student fraternity, the teaching fraternity, should be benefited most largely from his presence and his dissemination of knowledge. Probably he is a treasure house. We could learn from his expertise. Thank you, sir.
That's all.
We also have, that's one of the reasons why I said that I'm really indeed privileged. We have the who and who of the Niti Aayog. The Niti Aayog here has been placed in place of the formerly known Planning Commission. And this is one area which brings us the industry, the institution, and the government policy makers together. The universities have a large role in bridging this gap. We have with us today again another personality, Mr. B. N. Satpathy, the consultant for Niti Aayog. A consultant primarily because he is going to lay down the roadmap for us. With his experience, he could say on what track we should be. And I'm sure he will put us on the right track to see that this culminates in a much, much bigger area of activity between Mangalore University and Niti Aayog. He is formerly the senior advisor for ENAF and S&T industry, Niti Aayog Department of Information Technology, Ministry of Commerce and IT, Government of India. Shri B.N. Satpathy has a vast experience of 30 years in various domains and positions. Formerly, he has also served as a senior advisor for Planning Commission and as an economic advisor for 8 years. Prior to that, Shri B.N. Satpathy served the nation as a general manager of finance and training, advanced level telecom training, Bharat Sanchar Nigam Limited India, Department of Telecom, Ministry of Communications and Information Technology, Government of India. He has also served as additional economic advisor for Ministry of Commerce and Industry, New Delhi, also as the Joint Secretary of UPSC, New Delhi. He has his post-graduation and MPhil studies in economics from JNU, New Delhi and Punjab University, Chandigarh respectively. He has also acquired professional degrees from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. He has undergone special training on public administration at MIT, USA and environmental economics at World Bank, Washington, D.C., USA. I'm indeed really privileged to have this opportunity to introduce this honorable guest with us. And I think this would not have been a better platform for the university to really bring out a bigger, larger roadmap for the years to come in this area of GIAN programs, that is the Global Initiative of Academic Networks. I take this opportunity to thank the organizers of this one and an opportunity for having given me to introduce these honored guests with us. I again extend a warm welcome to all of you for looking forward for a continued support henceforth from this day, and a warm welcome to each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your warm welcome. Now, I request Professor K.M. Balakrishna, Dean, Faculty of Science and Technology, to florally welcome Sri Ratan P. Water. Chief guest of today's function. Thank you, sir. Now I request Professor V.S. Nagendra Prakash, Registrar, Mangalore University, to florally welcome Sri B.N. Satpathy. Today's program guest of honor. I request Professor Ravindra Chari to florally welcome Professor H.R. Rao. Professor Ravindrachari, Professor of Physics. Now I invite Professor Manjunath Pattabhi to formally welcome Sri K. Rajeshwar Rao, Professor of Material Science, Professor Manjunath Pattabhi. Now I request Professor V. S. Shekhar, Course Coordinator, to formally welcome Dean Faculty of Science and Technology, Professor K. M. Balakrishna. Now I invite Professor Manjaya D. H. to formally welcome Professor V. S. Nagendra Prakash, Registrar, Bangalore University. I request Professor Duraiswamy, Professor of Computer Science, to formally welcome Professor Ganesh Sanjeev, Professor of Physics and Local Gear Coordinator. Now I invite Professor Rachel Shashireka to formally welcome Professor Manjaya D.H. Professor Rachel Shashireka, Professor of Chemistry, Professor of Computer Science. Light symbolizes knowledge as it dispels the clouding darkness. It is the time to inaugurate the program by lighting the lamp. It is my honor to invite Professor Sri Ratan P. Water to inaugurate the program by lighting the lamp. I also request all other dignitaries on the left.
Participants, invitees, I stand before you to present the overall agenda of this 1 week GYAN program on digital payments, the technology for cashless society, which basically an initiation by Niti Aayog to take up this program. What motivates us to take up this program, I would be presenting along with the course content coverage, which would help the participants to plan around and to get an insight into the details of this particular technology. And it's purely an interdisciplinary concepts that we are planning to present over here, which definitely useful to all the people at all levels, be it a graduates from different sources, background, be it a humanities, science and technology, or engineering, or from the management, or from the commerce too. As we all know that the Government of India has constituted a committee to enable 100% conversion of government citizen transactions to the digital platform. In this direction, the committee aimed to identify and operationalize in the earliest possible time frame and user-friendly digital payment options in all sectors of the economy, which is an integral part of the government strategy to transform India into a cashless economy. and to achieve this in an exponential manner, digital payment economy across all states and sectors, a continuous rapid engagement with central ministries, state governments, district administration, trade and industry associations are being continuously making an attempts to promote the prompt adoption of digital payment systems. And also, it is necessary to estimate the cost involved in various digital payment options and oversee the implementation measures to make such transaction between the government and the citizens, which is supposed to be cheaper than the cash transaction, which is to be very well addressed. And hence, the committee led by Niti Aayog implement an action plan on advocacy, the awareness and handholding the efforts among the public, the micro enterprises and other stakeholders. And one such solution that Niti Aayog has thought to reach the public is by conduction of the programs through the 3-3 model. T3 in the sense that train the trainer model is employed here in a sense. In this context, under Gyan, the Niti Aayog initiated a program that reaches the public to know about the digital payments. And in this direction, they seek opinion and also to submit the proposal from various universities. And we submitted a proposal and fortunate to have this program in our university on digital payment, the technology for cashless society. What basically that going to be covered under this? As we all know that payment is a process of transferring money from the payer to the payee that involves payment instruments, payment processing and payment settlement. In particular, the electronic payment systems, monetary values are transferred electronically between a payer and the receiver. And the need for electronic payment technologies is to respond to fundamental changes in the socio-economic trends. And in particular, the payment system is the infrastructure which comprised of institutions, the instruments, the procedures, and the technically established procedures to affect the transfer of monetary value between all the parties. And I'm sure with the advent of modern technologies in the field of telecommunication, infrastructure and protocols, all our future payments, which is of course one of the grand initiative by our Honorable Prime Minister to have Digital India, part of this program is a digital payment, where future payments will be made through e-payments only, it is expected by B2B model or business to customer or customer to government. Although there are many complexities involved in the availability of the real data, the investment and the security, could be in terms of cyber loss and the cyber security, and the awareness and the literacy among the mass is supposed to be established. These are the complexities involved. And in order to overcome this complexity, so this GYAN program is one such means such that digital payment can take forward to the entire public, wherein which it is planned to have in this 5 days program, the course coverage which discusses about the introduction to money concepts, the fundamentals of tokenization, automated clearing and settlement systems. Because knowingly or unknowingly, we all performing these kind of tasks as a part of banking transactions. Could be trying through the money ATM networks, through a SWIFT or say NEFT transfer that we are following. And what kind of technology that is behind this particular kind of digital payment, e-payment security and digital signatures concepts are going to be covered over here, which particularly specifies about the protocol and the credit card networks. Apart from that, the smart and stored value cards, the octopus technology, RFID cards, gift card technology, and also the micropayments and mobile payment issues will also be discussed. And then we tend to use, as we all know that part of your smartphone, different types of digital wallets. It could be a Google wallet or an Apple Pay components, or it could be Samsung or an Android, or it could be a MasterPass and so on. All these issues, the principle and the philosophy behind all these issues will be covered. And also peer-to-peer, what we normally call it as a PayPal, electronic cash and virtual money systems will be discussed with the future of one such, although there are certain issues and debate in the context of what is called as a Bitcoin and virtual currencies. Still, what is the idea behind those technologies also going to be discussed. And finally, on the last day, It is proposed to cover the electronic invoice presentation and the payment system will be discussed. And whether this issue or digital payments is an evolution or a revolution is finally the question that is left to the audience in the final stage. And to cover these, all these concepts, we have established contacts with one of the renowned personality, Professor H. Raghavendra Rao, presently, as he is already introduced, that AT&T Distinguished Chair in Infrastructure Assurance and Security, University of Texas. He is with us today to discuss all these concepts. And we have received nearly 75 registration in the Gyan portal, and out of that, 45 students from the point of view of accommodating in-house hands-on sessions, 45 members have been considered. Out of this, we have students from BTech, BE and BCA background. Number of students enrolled is around 6. And there are 25 researchers from different disciplines from the field of computer science, business administration and MCOM. And also we have the faculty members from the humanities, from the commerce, MBA and computer science. Apart from that, we are also having the administrators from SancharNet, DOT, CDAC, and from the Central University, as well as MIE, IT. So these are the various participants that we have assembled here in order to know about the technology behind this digital payment. And I take this opportunity to thank the Niti Aayog initiation, as well as the Gyan MHRD, which approves this program and to take it forward to the greater extent. Thank you very much.
Honored for what he received. Honor has been the reward for what he gave. We have with us Sri B.N. Satpathy, today's program guest of honor, who is instrumental in executing this program, the Gyan program. Sir, I request you to address the gathering.
Respected Sri Ratham P. Vattal, Councillor Advisor Niti Aayog, and Member Secretary for Economic and Value Development, and today's chief guest, Professor Nagendra Prakash and other Professor H.R. Rao from University of Texas, Professor Shekhar, other dignitaries on the dais, and distinguished participants, representatives of MIT, DOT and other organizations. A very warm welcome to this. It's a great honor here to be here today to be part of this inaugural ceremony on the Gyan course. I'll briefly talk about the why, how we got involved in this, how I got involved in this, and what are the expectations from the course, and what's the way forward in the whole thing. Now, in August 2016, the Government of India set up a committee on digital payments under the chairmanship of Mr. Vattal, to recommend medium-term measures for promoting digital payments in the country. I was lucky to be a part of that endeavor, and the committee submitted its final report to the finance minister in December 2016. It is a series of recommendations, 33 in total, and all of them are being acted upon. I would urge Professor Shekhar to, if it is possible to look at the soft copy, all of you could look at that as a background material for the whole thing. Now, having said that, then came the rush of events to the demonetization which took place in November 2016, which led to a spurt in demand for the digital instruments for payments. Combined these two factors, we thought that there was a necessity to build awareness, skills and willingness to be part of the digital payment ecosystem. And that is when I am grateful to today's chief guest that he decided to write to Minister Bachardi to initiate a course on digital payments and the Gyan scheme. And this is how it all happened. And today we are here. This is the first course being organized by the Bangalore University in the whole country. And we are grateful to Professor Shekhar and to the entire university for doing this. This is not the last one. This is the first one, but will not be the last one. Some of the questions that were arising is, why no university is running a course on digital payments, while different colleges That is one of the reasons. There are different aspects in this. Technology is a prime mover in this. So the technology is a part of the computer science department. It is a part of economics also. When it talks about what does digital payment talk about, we talk about digital payment of money. So money in banking is a subject in the economics. So the economic discipline is also involved in the whole process. Central bank being a main player in the whole process. You talk about income elasticity of money, you talk about velocity of money, you talk about whatever, this is a part of this. So how does digital payment impact that? It is also a matter of statistics, how do you monitor the growth of the digital payment in volume and value? So who does that? What are the indicators globally and all that? So that's also one way. How does Bank of Japan do it? How does the Bank of Singapore do it? How does the Central Bank of India do it? So this is also a matter of statistics. One of the key importance of this digital payment ecosystem is that monthly per capita expenditure, which is done through a survey by the Minister of Statistics, is a very critical parameter for determining poverty line and all that, which was earlier there, which is no longer there. But that continues to be very important. Now, if you have digital payment as a means of monitoring that, now you don't have to do a survey which takes 1 or 2 years. So this is a very important subject of statistics also. Lastly, it is also a subject of sociology. When you talk about digital divide, when you talk about how does it impact the socially excluded people, and the FedEx report of World Bank talks about how exactly digital payment has enabled so many bank accounts to be opened without any freedom and all. So I think because this is a multidisciplinary, as Professor Sekhar was saying, that though no department has run this course so far, so there is a time now to have this as a course which is to be run, where all these persons from different departments would be a part of it, and also do a project work also on that. So that's the future of the whole thing. And I would urge Professor Sekhar that you to bring out the course material for this, so that we can take it forward to others. They can be a mentor for other universities. GYAN programs also they could do, but GYAN is only once in a while, it can't be a regular thing. So this is where our expectations from Bangalore University being the first mover in the whole thing, this is what I would. Now at the end, I would say, had it not been for the vision and the determination of Mr. Vattal, we would not have been here today. This course would not have happened on the GYAN course. I think he has been the champion in the whole process, and he has led the path for us. It is for us to take it forward and see that all universities in the country run such a program, so that there is a building of awareness, there is a building of skill, there is a building of willingness also to be a part of the digital payment ecosystem. It is something which affects all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your mission to enhance the quality of education, teaching and research. This program aims to aid the faculty, research scholars and students to exalt their level of knowledge in these areas. It's a great pleasure of having Professor H. Raghavendra Rao, resource person, GYAN, Professor of Computer Science, University of Texas, USA, an authority in the field of management information systems, cyber security, business analytics, etc. Now I request Professor H.R. Rao to share his views with audience.
So this was totally unexpected, because I thought you will be listening to me for the next 5 days. Why would you want me here today? But since I am on the spot and Professor Sekhar has insist that I should speak a few words, let me first start by thanking all of you, the professors in Bangalore University, the delegates from Niti Aayog, for bringing me here. Maybe a couple of things before I start. Pointed out that Professor Nagaraj pointed out that I was originally from here. One of my grandfathers was from Panambur. Does anyone know where Panambur is?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, so, and his name was Raghavendra Rao. And he was in the Indian Civil Services, ICS, if I remember correctly. Yes. So my parents used to say that he was a great man, and they named me hoping that I would become as great as him, but obviously that never happened. And I had five other uncles and aunts who also named their children Raghavendra in the hope that they would also become as great as but no one did. So, but anyway, it's good to come back here.
No way that you are still great. We consider you as great.
thank you. So, my father's side is from Hejamadi. Anyone know where that is?
Yes.
Okay, so I don't know where it is because I've never been to Hejamadi. But it's interesting and completely irrelevant to the topic for the next 5 days. But my name is Hejamadi Raghavendra Rao. And in the US, nobody can pronounce Hejamadi, they cannot pronounce Raghavendra, and they cannot pronounce Rao. But the way the assumption is that the first name is what you are called by. So if somebody calls me on the phone and says, "Can I speak to Hejamadi?" then I immediately know it is some marketer. And I say, "No, Hejamadi is not here." And if somebody calls and says, "Raghavendra," then I know it has to be from South Canada because nobody else can pronounce Raghavendra. Usually my colleagues call me Raghav. They've truncated the name. And Rao they can't pronounce, they say Rio. So usually I'm known as Professor HR. That is the easiest.
Can we give a new nomenclature to you, sir?
Yes, please.
Mr. Sheikh, I think next time, anytime, whenever we have the opportunity, he must be addressed as Hejamadi Raghavendra Rao only in his full name, so that he knows it is from Bangalore University.
Yeah, only Bangalore University people know where Hejamadi is. So anyway, so I would like to thank Professor Shekhar for getting me involved in the Gyan program and the proposal for the digital payments. And as I understand from Sri Vatal, this is probably one of the first in the country. Hopefully, I will be giving you something useful for you to take home and think about in the next few days. With that, I'll pass it on to the next person. Thank you.
Ratan P. Water with us with a strategic vision whose responsibilities are exercised in a fair, open and responsive manner. Sir, I invite you to address the hearing.
Thank you. Professor Nagendra Prakash, Registrar. Professor Raghavendra Rao, whom I'm so glad I met in this morning. Well, we met last night and we had this very interesting conversation this morning. Course coordinator Shekhar, who I've been in touch with personally and also on various video conferences. Professor Sanjeev, Professor Manjaya, other dignitaries, professors sitting on the dais, participants who've come for this Gyan program, students and other faculty members of Mangalore University. I'm first very thankful to the Vice Chancellor who I met yesterday, Professor Kishore Kumar, for the hospitality that he has given us, the warm welcome, along with Professor Nagendra Prakash and the faculty members, to my team comprising Rajeshwar Rao and Mr. Satpati. I was looking forward to coming here to Mangalore, and this program had been decided a long time back. In fact, this is the third institution that I am visiting, and in some sense it's also been explained why this course is being held, what it's all about, I'll dwell a little more on that. In fact, Shekhar just showed you the outline of the course, the Gyan course, which will be, you'll be talking about it along with the participants over the next 5 days. But here as I talk, actually there are some ideas which were coming to me that how we will look into the future beyond this Gyan course, how we'll take it forward. You see, this Gyan was a program which was started by the Ministry of Human Resources Development as a network internationally amongst academic institutions, where it was a kind of a twinning program that a professor or a department of a particular university in India would twin with a professor or a department of another university abroad in some very frontline area of academic interest, and it would be funded, of course, by the HRD ministry, and this program would be done in that particular university by inviting, it was not an open program, it's by invitation, students come in and study it, and I think 400-500 of these programs are conducted. It's a very, every year, it's a very interesting and a very useful program. But from NITI, when I found this, and I have also worked in the HRD ministry earlier, I was having a chat with the secretary, and I told him that while it's very good, academic excellence and networking is very good, we also have a large number of national initiatives, and in fact national challenges which we have to address. And this platform could be a very good area where the academic, the policy maker and the implementer can be brought on one forum. And I'm glad that the mix of people which I see who are going to participate in this program are of that mix. So the whole idea here was that pick up some items or some topics which are actually relevant to the country in the coming future, where we require the inputs from let's say the academic pool also. So we started on two things. One was digital payments. Everybody has heard about demonetization and all that. It's been the talk of the town. Some people, it's also a talk of debate whether it was right or wrong, etc. I'm not getting into all that. So that's why we are here for, and I'll talk about it. But just in passing, I'll mention the other area which was of interest was on urban planning and urban analytics. This is another area which I think it's a huge challenge in this country. As you may know, that in the next 10 to 15 years, actually 50% of the population of this country will start living in urban or peri-urban towns. I mean, we keep saying that we all live in villages, but actually our villages are becoming towns. Now, it's a huge challenge because the way towns are managed are very different than the way villages are managed. I mean, both should be managed well. But this is an area which we are looking at also in other parts of this Gyan program, where we have picked up some institutions where urban planning, urban architecture, etc. is taught in universities, and we are dealing with town planning bodies, state governments, etc. to see that we can be put in systems in place where, you know, small villages which are becoming towns don't become just dirty old towns which we are all used to in this country. They should become livable towns with all the features, security, and all the whatever is expected of a good township should be there in these places. So that's a huge challenge, and that's something which we are also looking at. Now, coming to digital payments, as was mentioned, it happened in November 7th. There was this whole decision which the government took on withdrawing nearly 80% of the cash from the economy by changing the denominations, etc., on the 7th of November in 2016. It was done for various reasons. We all know that, black money, counterfeiting, etc. But you see, before that, as was mentioned, in August itself, and incidentally, of course, these things were mentioned about my experience, but I actually retired from the Government of India as the Finance Secretary of the Ministry of Finance. So I was there and I retired in April, and immediately after that, around August, the Finance Minister said that why don't you look at a group which looks at digital payments. It had nothing to do with demonetization or anything like that, because the payment system, what are payments? Payments are something very basic to social interaction. I mean, everything started with barter. That was also a payment system. You have salt, you buy something, you buy wheat with it, you do it in weight, etc. So a lot of you might be knowing the evolution of money, how it came up. So money is really an instrument which actually facilitates payments. But money and all these things might be actually addressed over there in the course, but I'm just to make things simple. Money is also something which holds value. I mean, that's why banks are there. That's why the Central Bank of India or the Reserve Bank of India is there. Because you can invest money, you can save it, you can get interest out of it. The bank then probably lends it to a factory or a business and it makes money out of that. It pays you a part of it. So there's a whole business aspect to money. So any cash has two aspects. It's a facilitator of payments. It's a facilitator for investments and for making the economy grow. Now, both these functions are basically regulated by the central bank or the reserve bank in our country. It's not true in all countries. You see, as things have evolved, the nature of payments has also kept changing. Now, I'll make a very simple statement. I don't want to give you reasons, etc. for it, but cash is fairly modern in a sense, cash as an instrument of payment. But it has now become, it is not as efficient. It was efficient at one time. You have, technology has given you other systems of payments which are actually cheaper. So the whole logic of moving to a digital payment system is because there are other systems available which are cheaper than cash payments. I mean, cash looks simple. You know, you go to an ATM, you take some money out. Eventually, you use that cash to make your payments. It's not really all that digital. But there is always a cost in it. Of course, there's a cost of producing a note or a bill, which gets covered by seniorage, etc. There are ways of doing it. But just imagine that you use a car, you go to an ATM, or you go somewhere, you draw money, you go somewhere else, you put time into it. There is a cost to using cash also, which is always not trapped in the usage of money. And evidently, I mean, there's some study by the RBI or something that every time you probably use 1 rupee in a transaction of cash, you're actually spending 1 rupee 15 paisa, in the sense that it, which is not being seen, but somewhere in the economy it's an inefficiency. You know, it's like if it's an inefficient machine, it might produce more kinetic, sound or something. Physics people might be able to explain it to you better. If it's managed better, it can be done. So that is the whole logic behind digital payments. And as was mentioned, that I was just asked to look at what could be the medium term measures to improve the system of digital payments in this country, because other modern economies, which are where we are also somewhere in that same club, that how can we have systems where our digital payments just improve, because they were anyway going up, both in terms of, you measure payments in terms of volume and value. I'll touch on that also a little bit. Now, everything, again, you must understand, in a country or any system, is based on a system of law. Even payments are based on a system of law. There is something called the Payments and Settlements Act of 2007, which actually defines what is a digital payment or an electronic. I mean, that's the whole challenge, because incidentally that act is under review. So it's not a very old act, it's 2007, where the whole legal framework for how payments have to be regulated, administered, secured, is enshrined in that act. The implementer of that act, that means what comes out of an act are laws, regulations, things like that, which are called subordinate legislations, is done by the Reserve Bank of India. The Reserve Bank of India doesn't, it's a regulator. It doesn't create the law. It's the parliament which creates the law, the government which proposes the law, and the regulator regulates it. And as long as the law is in place, it will only regulate what is written in the law. Now, where the contradiction comes in is that you have, again, in universities and startups, etc., people are thinking, new technologies are coming, new ideas are coming up about, I'm just talking of the payment system. You've heard of fintech and all these. NASSCOM is working on ideas. People are coming with bright ideas, how this can be done, that can be done. But it can't be implemented. Why? Because there's a law. The law, the RBI will not do anything unless the law is changed. So one of the prescriptions of this report was that the PESA Act has to now take into account the fast changing technologies in the area of payments, which can be regulated. Because again, money is something which you can't leave it to the, you know, just to the free play of the market. It has to be regulated because you can have systemic problems, etc. You can have a run on the money, all kinds of things. That's why you need a central regulator. So in fact, the good news is that that's something which you could look at online, etc., is the PESA Act is actually by the Ministry of Finance been re-looked at. There is a new revised act which is probably going to be taken to the Parliament. Now there's a process in Parliament for changing law, etc. The whole idea there was that how do you balance the fact that you do need regulation, you need safety, you need security. Because just like your pocket can get picked on the roadside, or some guy can create dacoity by maybe hitting you and taking your money, same things can happen in the virtual world. You know, people can steal your wallet. Dacoits can take away your money on the virtual highways. So it's a, if you see the real world, now those provisions have to be worked out in this law, which gives you security, but yet it should not be so tight that it doesn't allow the use of new technology to enter into this field. So, and in India, it's good. We work slowly. We don't have to have knee-jerk reactions to think this law will be probably discussed in the parliament, etc. We'll move ahead. So that's a major challenge. Now, that's exactly what this Gyan is trying to do. And this proposal actually came from Shekhar from Bangalore University, and I was very happy that somebody is going to look in this Gyan platform where we can bring in these practitioners, policy makers, students, professors, who will look at any aspect or various aspects of how we move from a cash to a cashless society, taking into account all these things, technology, law, systems of payments, which have been talked about in detail. Now this, incidentally, though we have been talking about it, is not being implemented. You'd be surprised that nobody teaches digital payments anywhere. You go to administrative training institutions, you can go to Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of Administration in Mussoorie, where the IAS chaps are trained. There is no, I asked somebody, has there been a course being run on this? They said no, somebody gave a 1 hour talk from NPCI or somewhere. You see, nobody has thought about actually capacity building in this area. And that's where the university plays a major role. And you know, I was so happy, it's just incidental that Bangalore University suggested this. We are doing this over here. And I come here, I mean, I knew always, but I rediscovered that Mangalore is also the place where the enterprise of private banking came up over here. All your, you know, syndicate, any bank you associated in the private syndicate bank, Karnataka bank, two, three others are there, a corporation bank. I mean, it's all from this area. I mean, there were bankers who came out of this area you have a university here which is talking of digital payments. Maybe this could be the next step. How do we involve these banks? Because I think their head offices or the chairman, whatever, they might be still here. I'll go back, and that's the way we build on it, because this Gyan program should not be just a one-off thing that we do it and we forget about it. In fact, that's what I was telling Raghavendra, that you know, he's from IIT Kanpur. That was not mentioned, though he's from here. But he's a graduate of engineering, a graduate from this place. He should maintain his linkage over. He comes here every year or every 1.5 years. I'm sure he comes to meet his family or whatever. Maybe with Mangalore University, the banking system, etc., we can develop this kind of long-term twinning. And he has done work on cyber, on security. You know, that's one of the biggest challenges which this digital payments that we have, which the computer sciences department here could look at. You see, whether you take plastic cards, these what are they called, Rupee or Maestro or Visa and all that, all of them are sitting on some algorithms, on some spines, I would say, some backbone on which all these things are developed. I don't know how secure they are. Maybe it's you who has to tell, you know, tell the banking sector how good they are. I've been told that the American Federal Reserve has actually done away a lot of these old systems which formed a part of their cashless system and gone into new, more secure methods of seeing that cash payments are done. Do we need to do that? This is something which we have to look at, and where HR can help us with his knowledge. So maybe after this program is over, maybe the Shekhar, we can have a talk again together. We can see how Mangalore University can tie up with these banking institutions. And incidentally, I'm already working on a program on e-learning. You know, you can nowadays do e-learning modules also with the NIBM, the National Institution of Banking Management, which is in Pune. They are very interested, but they are dealing with mostly public sector banks and things like that. Now we will share this, and that program is incidentally, they are just running a course, but actually with Mr. Satpathy, he's coordinating with the ITU, the International Telecommunications Union, which sits in Geneva. Some of their people are helping us devise these programs. Now you could have a look at it. In fact, Mangalore University could become the leader as a trainer of trainers. You can at least do it in Karnataka, nowhere else, that people understand what it's about. And I'll see to it that if you need any assistance, I'll tell the whoever has to be told in the HRD ministry, to, or if necessary, if I have to speak to the chief secretary here or the higher education secretary in Bangalore, I can do that, so that this thing is mainstreamed. And as I said, it should be continued, this kind of thing. Now we are doing that in a very similar way I had mentioned to you about urban analytics and all that. Just the other day, the other university that I had gone to was Roorkee, which has a very good center for urban planning and architecture. So we decided with the state of Uttarakhand, government of Uttarakhand, to identify a village. Again, as I said, villages becoming towns. You see, you get a lot of earthquakes there. It's seismically prone area. I said, identify a village which is most seismically endangered. Let us use technology which is being developed in that university, in that IIT. And they have done a lot of work on earthquake technologies, about how to make buildings and all that. But it's all at the workshop level. It's not gone out. It's not got. Let's try and implement it actually in a small town. I can't say that I'll do it in a big city. But you know, there are processes the way we can do it. Just set up a team and see how we can actually plan a small village so it becomes a bigger place. Something like that could be done here. where we take up, you said, how do you have outreach? Maybe Syndicate Bank and you can work together and in some areas see that digital payments are, you know, whatever the challenges are, can be addressed at that level. This could be done very easily. The students can help out, the professors can help out, you're locally available here, everything is available here. So that was the purpose of my coming here, in the sense that, as I said, you all have heard of the Niti Aayog. It's very different than the Planning Commission used to really hand out money and budgets, etc., on development programs. This is more of a think tank of the government. And here, while we do a lot of other things, but I thought this capacity building in this, you know, there's no point in just talking about digital payments and this and that. Let's get down with the job, even if it's a small drop in the ocean. Let's start from Bangalore, and then the ripple effect will be there all over. And again, as I said, I'm very happy that you've taken this initiative, your VC, your registrar, Shekhar. And again, I'm very happy that people like Raghavendra are here all the way from Texas to give this program. But let this not be your last engagement with this university.
Certainly
just
not.
Make it continuous.
I should do that.
I think you're a jewel that they've found and they must hold on to you. Thank you. Like your grandfather. Thank you.